nestled or snug in their beds, while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads. A mama in a kerchief and I in my cap had just settled our brains for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there arose such a clatter, I sprang from the bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters and threw up the sash. The moon on the breast of the new fallen snow gave the luster of midday to objects below, when what to my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer. With a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew in a moment it must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles his coursers they came, and he whistled and shouted and called them by name. Now Dasher, now Dancer, now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet, on Cupid, on Donder and Blitzen, to the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all. As dry leaves that before the wild hurricane fly, when they meet with an obstacle, mount to the sky. So up to the housetop the coursers they flew, with a sleigh full of toys and St. Nicholas too. And then in a twinkling I heard on the roof the prancing and pawing of each little hoof. As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound. He was dressed all in fur from his head to his foot, and his clothes were all tarnished with ashes and soot. A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes how they twinkled, his dimples how merry, his cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard of his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. He was chubby and plump, a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him in spite of myself. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread. He spoke not a word but went straight to his work and filled all the stockings, then turned with a jerk. And laying his finger aside of his nose, and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his sleigh, to his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim, ere he drove out of sight, "Happy Christmas to all, and to all a good night." how those stately great trees crashed to the ground, how their limbs were lopped off, and how lean they looked as the naked trunks were loaded into carts. It could hardly recognize the trees it had known when the horses pulled them out of the woods. Where were they going? What would become of them? In the springtime, when swallows and storks came back, the tree asked them, "Do you know where the other trees went? Have you met them?" The swallows knew nothing about it, but the stork looked thoughtful and nodded his head. "Yes, I think I met them," he said. "On my way from Egypt, I met many new ships, and some had tall, stately masts. They may well have been the trees you mean, for I remember the smell of fir. They wanted to be remembered to you." "Oh, I wish I were old enough to travel on the sea. Please tell me what it really is and how it looks." "That would take too long to tell," said the stork, and off he strode. "Rejoice in your youth," said the sunbeams. "Take pride in your growing strength and in the stir of life within you." And the wind kissed the tree, and the dew wept over it, for the tree was young and without understanding. When Christmas came near, many young trees were cut down. Some were not even as old or as tall as this fir tree of ours, who is in such a hurry and fret to go travelling. These young trees, which were always the handsomest ones, had their branches left on them when they were loaded on carts, and the horses drew them out of the woods. "Where can they be going?" the fir tree wondered. "They are no taller than I am. One was really much smaller than I am. And why are they allowed to keep all of their branches? Where can they be going?" "We know, we know," the sparrows chirped. "We have been to town and peeped in the windows. We know where they are going. The greatest splendour and glory you can imagine awaits them. We've peeped through the windows. We've seen them planted right in the middle of a warm room and decked out with the most splendid things. Gold apples, gold gingerbread, gay toys, and many hundreds of candles." "And then?" asked the fir tree, trembling in every twig. "And then? What happens then?" "We saw nothing more, and never have we seen anything that could match it. I wonder if I was created for such a glorious future," the fir tree rejoiced. "Why, that is better than to cross the sea. I'm tormented with longing. Oh, if Christmas would only come. I'm just as tall and grown up as the trees they chose last year. How I wish I were already in the cart, on my way to the warm room, where there's so much splendour and glory." Then something even better, something still more important is bound to happen. Or why should they deck me so fine? Yes, there must be something still grander. But what? Oh, how I long. I don't know what's the matter with me." "Enjoy us while you may," the air and sunlight told him. "Rejoice in the days of your youth, out here in the open." But the tree did not rejoice at all. It just grew. It grew and was green, both winter and summer, dark evergreen. People who passed it said, "There's a beautiful tree," and when Christmas time came again, they cut it down first. The axe struck deep into its marrow. The tree sighed as it fell to the ground. It felt faint with pain. Instead of the happiness it had expected, the tree was sorry to leave the home where it had grown up. It knew that never again would it see its dear old comrades, the little bushes and the flowers about it, and perhaps not even the birds. The departure was anything but pleasant. The tree did not get over it until all the trees were unloaded in the yard. And it heard a man say, "That's a splendid one. That's the tree for us." The two servants came in fine livery and carried the fir tree into a big, splendid drawing room. Portraits were hung all around the walls. On either side of the white porcelain stove stood great Chinese vases with lions on their lids. There were easy chairs, silk-covered sofas, and long tables strewn with picture books and with toys that were worth a mint of money, or so the children said. The fir tree was planted in a large tub filled with sand, but no one could see that it was a tub because it was wrapped in a gay green cloth and set on a many-coloured carpet. How the tree quivered! What would come next? The servants and even the young ladies helped it on with its fine decorations. From its branches, they hung little nets cut out of coloured paper, and each net was filled with candies. Gilded apples and walnuts hung in clusters as if they grew there, and 100 little white, blue, and even red candles were fastened to its twigs. Among its green branches swayed dolls that it took to be real living people, for the tree had never seen peered in among the branches, but this was only to make sure that not an apple or fig had been overlooked. "Tell us a story, tell us a story," the children clamoured, as they towed a fat little man to the tree. He sat down beneath it and said, "Here we are in the woods, and it will do the tree a lot of good to listen to our story. Mind you, I'll tell only one. Which will you have, the story of Ivedy Avedy, or the one about Humpty Dumpty who tumbled downstairs, yet ascended the throne and married the princess?" "Ivedy Avedy," cried some, "Humpty Dumpty," cried the others, and there was a great hullabaloo. Only the fir tree held its peace, though it thought to itself, "Am I to be left out of this? Isn't there anything I can do?" For all the fun of the evening had centered upon it, and it had played its part well. The fat little man told them all about Humpty Dumpty, who tumbled downstairs, yet ascended the throne and married the princess. And the children clapped and shouted, "Tell us another one, tell us another one," for they wanted to hear about Ivedy Avedy too. But after Humpty Dumpty, the storytelling stopped. The fir tree stood very still as it pondered how the birds in the woods had never told it a story to equal this. Humpty Dumpty tumbled downstairs, yet he married the princess. Imagine, that must be how things happen in the world. You never can tell. "Maybe I'll tumble downstairs and marry a princess too," thought the fir tree, who believed every word of the story because such a nice man had told it. The tree looked forward to the following day, when they would deck it again with fruit and toys, candles and gold. "Tomorrow I shall not quiver," it decided. "I'll enjoy my splendor to the full. Tomorrow I shall hear about Humpty Dumpty again, and perhaps about Ivedy Avedy too." All night long the tree stood silent as it dreamed its dreams, and next morning the butler and the maid came in with their dusters. "Now my splendor will be renewed," the fir tree thought. But they dragged it upstairs to the garret, and there they left it in a dark corner where no daylight ever came. "What's the meaning of this?" the tree wondered. "What am I going to do here? What story shall I hear?" It leaned against the wall, lost in dreams. It had plenty of time for dreaming as the days and nights went by. Nobody came to the garret, and when at last someone did come, it was only to put many big boxes away in the corner. The tree was quite hidden. One might think it had been entirely forgotten. "It's still winter outside," the tree thought. "The earth is too hard and covered with snow for them to plant me now. I must have been put here for shelter until springtime comes. How thoughtful of them. How good people are. Only I wish it weren't so dark here and so very, very lonely. There's not even a little hare. It was so friendly out in the woods when the snow was on the ground and the hare came hopping along. Yes, he was friendly even when he jumped right over me, though I did not think so then. Here it's all so terribly lonely." "Squeak, squeak," said a little mouse just then. He crept across the floor and another one followed him. They sniffed the fir tree and rustled in and out among its branches. "It is fearfully cold," one of them said. "Except for that, it would be very nice here, wouldn't it, you old fir tree?" "I'm not at all old," said the fir tree. "Many trees are much older than I am." "Where did you come from?" the mice asked him. "And what do you know?" They were most inquisitive creatures. "Tell us about the most beautiful place in the world. Have you been there? Were you ever in the larder, where there are cheeses on shelves and hams that hang from the rafters? It's the place where you can dance upon tallow candles, where you can dart in thin and squeeze out fat." "I know nothing of that place," said the tree, "but I know the woods where the sun shines and the little birds sing." Then it told them about its youth. The little mice had never heard the like of it. They listened very intently and said, "My, how much you have seen, and how happy it must have made you." Aye, the fir tree thought about it. Yes, those days were rather amusing, and it went on to tell them about Christmas Eve, when it was decked out with candies and candles. "Oh," said the little mice, "how lucky you have been, you old fir tree." "I'm not at all old," it insisted. "I came out of the woods just this winter, and I'm really in the prime of life, though at the moment my growth is suspended." "How nicely you tell things," said the mice. The next night they came with four other mice to hear what the tree had to say. The more it talked, the story. Don't you know one that tells about bacon and candles? Can't you tell us a good larder story? No, said the tree. Then goodbye, and we won't be back, the rat said, and went away. At last the little mice took to staying away too. The tree sighed. Oh, wasn't it pleasant when those gay little mice sat around and listened to all that I had to say? Now that too is past and gone, but I will take good care to enjoy myself once they let me out of here. When would that be? Well, it came to pass on a morning when people came up to clean out the garret. The boxes were moved, the tree was pulled out and thrown hard on the floor. But a servant dragged it at once to the stairway, where there was daylight again. Now my life will start all over, the tree thought. It felt the fresh air and the first sunbeam strike it as if it came out into the courtyard. This all happened so quickly, and there was so much going around it that the tree forgot to give even a glance at itself. The courtyard adjoined a garden where flowers were blooming. Great masses of fragrant roses hung over the picket fence. The linden trees were in blossom, and between them the swallows skimmed past, calling, "Lyra, Lyra Lee, my love's come back to me." But it was not the fir tree of whom they spoke. "Now I shall live again," it rejoiced, and tried to stretch out its branches. Alas, they were withered and brown and brittle. It was tossed into a corner among weeds and nettles, but the gold star that was still tied to its top sparkled bravely in the sunlight. Several of the merry children who had danced around the tree and taken such pleasure in it at Christmas were playing in the courtyard. One of the youngest seized upon it and tore off the tinsel star. "Look what is still hanging on that ugly old Christmas tree," the child said, and stamped upon the branches until they cracked beneath his shoes. The tree saw the beautiful flowers blooming freshly in the garden. It saw itself and wished that they had left it in the darkest corner of the garret. It thought of its own young days in the deep woods, and of the merry Christmas Eve, and of the little mice who had been so pleased when it told them the story of Humpty Dumpty. "My days are over and past," said the poor tree. "Why didn't I enjoy them while I could? Now they are gone, all gone." A servant came and chopped the tree into little pieces. These heaped together quite high. The wood blazed beautifully under the big copper kettle, and the fir tree moaned so deeply that each groan sounded like a muffled shot. That's why the children who were playing nearby ran to make a circle around the flames, staring into the fire and crying, "Piff Paff!" But as each groans burst from it, the tree thought of a bright summer day in the woods, or a starlit winter night. It thought of Christmas Eve, and thought of Humpty Dumpty, which was the only story it ever heard, and knew how to tell. And so the tree was burnt completely away. Children played on the courtyard. The youngest child wore in his breast the gold star that had topped the tree on its happiest night of all. But that was no more, and the tree was no more, and there's no more to my story. No more, nothing more. All stories come to an end. The last one I'll read is The Little Match Girl by Hans Christian Andersen. It was so terribly cold. Snow was falling and it was almost dark. Evening came on, the last evening of the year. In the cold and gloom, a poor little girl, bareheaded and barefoot, was walking through the streets. Of course, when she had left her house, she'd had slippers on, but what good had they been? They were very big slippers, way too big for her, for they belonged to her mother. The little girl had lost them running across the road, where two carriages had rattled by terribly fast. One slipper she'd not been able to find again, and a boy had run off with the other, saying he could use it very well as a cradle some day when he had children of his own. And so the little girl walked on her naked feet, which were quite red and blue with the cold. In an old apron she carried several packages of matches, and she held a box of them in her hand. No one had bought any from her all day long, and no one had given her a cent. Shivering with cold and hunger, she crept along, a picture of misery, poor little girl. The snowflakes fell on her long, fair hair, which hung in pretty curls over her neck. In all the windows, lights were shining, and there was a wonderful smell of roast. roast goose, for it was New Year's Eve. Yes, she thought of that. In a corner formed by two houses, one of which projected farther out into the street than the other, she sat down and drew up her little feet under her. She was getting colder and colder, but did not dare to go home, for she had sold no matches, nor earned a single cent, and her father would surely beat her. Besides, it was cold at home, for they had nothing over them but a roof through which the wind whistled, even though the biggest cracks had been stuffed with straw and rags. Her hands were almost dead with cold. Oh, how much one little match might warm her. If she could only take one from the box and rub it against the wall and warm her hands. She drew one out. She held her hands over it, but it gave a strange light. It really seemed to the little girl as if she was sitting before a great iron stove, with shining brass knobs and a brass cover. How wonderfully the fire burned. How comfortable it was. The youngster stretched out her feet to warm them too. Then the little flame went out. The stove vanished, and she had only the remains of the burnt match in her hand. She struck another match against the wall. It burned brightly, and when the light fell upon the wall, it became transparent like a thin veil, and she could see through it into a room. On the table, a snow-white cloth was spread, and on it stood a shining dinner service. The roast goose steamed gloriously, stuffed with apples and prunes, and what was still better, the goose jumped down from the dish and waddled along the floor with a knife and fork in its breast, right over to the little girl. Then the match went out, and she could see only the thick, cold wall. She lighted another match. Then she was sitting under the most beautiful Christmas tree. It was much larger and much more beautiful than the one she had seen last Christmas through the glass door at the rich merchant's home. Thousands of candles burned on the green branches, and coloured pictures, like those in the print shops, looked down at her. The little girl reached both her hands toward them. Then the match went out. But the Christmas lights mounted higher. She saw them now as bright stars in the sky. One of them fell down, forming a long line of fire. Now someone is dying, thought the little girl. Her old grandmother, the only person who had loved her and who was now dead, had told her that when a star fell down, a soul went up to God. She rubbed another match against the wall. It became bright again, and in the glow, the old grandmother stood clear and shining, kind and lovely. Grandmother, cried the child, oh, take me with you. I know you will disappear when the match is burned out. You will vanish like the warm stove, the wonderful roast goose, and the beautiful big Christmas tree. And she quickly struck the whole bundle of matches, for she wished to keep her grandmother with her. And the matches burned with such a glow that became brighter than daylight. Grandmother had never been so grand and beautiful. She took the little girl in her arms, and both of them flew in brightness and joy above earth. Very, very high, and up there was neither cold nor hunger nor fear. They were with God. But in the corner, leaning against the wall, sat the little girl with the red cheeks and smiling mouth, frozen to death on the last evening of the old year. The New Year's sun rose upon a little pathetic figure. The child sat there, stiff and cold, holding the matches, of which one bundle was almost burned. She wanted to warm herself, the people said. No one imagined what beautiful things she had seen, and how happily she had gone with her old grandmother into the bright new year.